Hello. Yeah. Okay. Welcome everybody to this panel, and thanks for staying back. I'm very happy that we have a very diverse panel today, and I take the opportunity to introduce it. Before that, why are we doing this panel? I think there are a lot of questions in our heads. Or let me speak for myself. I think there are a lot of questions in my head when it comes to women in technology, women in startups. Are our problems really real? Are our problems perceived? What do we feel is really legitimate, or is this just something that we have to overcome? And I think these are not really easy questions to answer, because it's not just about the mind, it's about mindset. And I think the idea really is to learn from the stories of three people that we have over here, and to see what we have to take away from these stories. So the way the panel will be structured is I'll introduce the panelists, and we'll have two rounds of questions with them, following which I really encourage all of you to come out and ask questions. Don't feel shy. Ask the most, I think ask a question that you think is important to you, and that means and matters a lot to you. The idea is really to have this exchange and this dialogue today, and not just to have like a one-way conversation over here. So I really hope you'll participate in the spirit of participation today. So on the panel with me today, we have Richa Khanna, who's a software engineer at Ola Cabs. She's been programming since 2006. And she's developed different products for Ola Store and Ola Share, and many other features before she's moved on to backend engineering in Ola. We have with us Neha Bagaria, who's a two-times entrepreneur, is currently the founder of Jobs for Her, an online portal to enable women to restart their careers after a break. I'm sure Neha will have a lot of interesting things to tell us. And then we have Leena Essen. I think there's no moment that I have felt prouder about Hasgeek conferences than to have Leena on stage here with us. I think Leena's first speaking career really began with DroidCon 2011. And I think more than anything else, I've been very grateful and appreciative of how Leena has been so contributing to the Hasgeek community, whether it comes to DevOps, whether it comes to JavaScript, whether it comes to DroidCon. Leena is a regular instructor and speaker at Hasgeek conferences. Moreover, Leena is the co-founder of Multinus. She's the CTO for over 8 years now. And she's also very active in the RubyConf community and is the organizer of Garden City RubyConf. So with that, I'd really like you to welcome all the panelists on stage. I'd like to start with the first question. I think it'll be nice if each of the panelists sort of spent about 5 minutes each talking about, you know, your journey, what got you into doing what you're doing today, and what are the kind of challenges you faced, and also what are the kind of successes that you've experienced in the process? What factors do you think have really influenced your decision to be where you are? And I think, Neha, you will have a lot to speak from the experiences that you've also encountered from other women. So maybe I should start with Richa.
Hi, Zainab. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to share the panel with you all. What I would like to say that I got fascinated with computers, programs, when I saw the first my C++ program in 2006. And then I decided that I wanted to pursue my career in technology, and I got my bachelor's and master's in computer science, and then I landed up in Texas Instruments, where I got this internship opportunity through college placements. And there I decided that I'm going to, you know, pursue from here only. So in my journey, what I have seen is when I was doing internship, so at that time I've seen people, the women are there in the freshers roles, in the SD1 role, SD2 role, but as the role becomes greater and higher, the women are very less. So I've always had a question in my mind, why I'm not going to give up, I'm not going to sacrifice my ambitions, why become less ambitious? Have you seen any guys becoming less ambitious when they become father or something like that? No. So that's how, after my internship, I was exploring new technologies, and then my friend suggested me to check out Android, and then after some of the workshops I attended and started learning myself, I saw a good opportunity there, and then I began my Android journey, and then I landed up in a startup called Snapshopper. After there, I worked on their visual search app. I developed myself and led the development for a couple of 9-10 months. Then after that stint, I joined JobNow, and and led the development of 3 Android apps there. There also, in, I didn't find the senior woman in engineering there. Then after that, I moved to Ola. When I joined Ola, I was happy that, you know, in Ola, girls are there. So my journey became, you know, making friends with a girl. I'm not like, okay, no, you should hire a girl because she's a girl. No, you should hire on skills, but at least encourage girls to come forward to be in tech roles. Because in my college where I studied, there are a lot of women and they were good in academia. So what happened after that? So that is the question we have. So when I'm in my company, I always ask my managers, you know, to check whether to go to events and see what are the different women in engineering roles coming and talk to them. So that's how you can ask other women to join in your team. Thank you.
Maybe Leena, you could continue and then Neha could take over.
Thanks, Zainab and Hasgeek team for inviting me. I started my speaking career at with Hasgeek, so I've been a regular at Hasgeek events. Regarding my journey, it started pretty early. I still write code. I'm heading the engineering team, but still write code. Computers really excites me, but I was never a I don't know how many of you knew this. I was never an engineering. I never came from an engineering background. I never did BTech or anything. I just did a diploma course. Then I realized, okay, this is my path to take forward. I'm basically a commerce graduate, but I stopped my commerce, the connection for commerce after once I took my path to computer. So, like what she mentioned, I think I've hardly seen women taking up roles. Usually, wherever I join, I'll be one among the two of three people at the company. Even though we have seen a lot of skilled ladies or girls who can do a lot of things, but they stop abruptly. So I think Neha will have a lot of stories to share on that front. But I don't know whether I have given enough thought about it, whether I should have given enough thought about it. I don't know. I've always been focused on, okay, one thing that I've decided that I am not going to stop my ambitions because I have a family. It's not easy. I have 2 kids. Luckily, things worked out well. I'm thankful for that to my friends, my family for doing that. But I the decision always came from me that, okay, I took maternity leave. I had a few months of breaks whenever I had to go for my maternity. But after that, I decided, okay, I'm not going to stop. Okay, let me see how far it can go. And then let's see when they start going to school, maybe I have to stop. But until then, I'll continue. Like that, it continued. And even the co-founder thing was very accidental. One of my friends started the company, YD, and then I just joined him. I didn't think about how far I can go. And he was also very open, okay, let's see how far it can go. And then it's been 9 years since we worked together, and then we are happy where we are. We are trying to take it forward also. But it's been a challenging story. Whether it was different because I was a woman, I don't know. Because the challenge exists for everyone to build, if you have to build your career. But I've seen very few women, whether I've actively did something to change that, I don't think so. Other than the fact that whoever talks to me, I encourage them to continue their career. One more thing that I can do, only time will tell, is to encourage my daughters to have a career in their life. Don't just stop because it's too tough. So that's the only thing whether I've done anything actively, that's the only thing I did. Whether I'm interested in doing it forward, of course, yes, because I've started noticing things more, because maybe I've just concentrated on my own thing so far. Now I have become aware of these things. Maybe I can do more. So I'd like to let Neha continue because she will have the most amount of stories, I believe.
Hi everyone, so my name is Neha Bagaria. I think I'm the only non-techie in this room.
Oh, really? Okay, that's good to know. But so I'm actually a finance and marketing graduate. I graduated from the Wharton School in the University of Pennsylvania. And I did a typical internship, summer internship at an investment bank, decided that's not for me, was much more interested in social entrepreneurship. So started an educational center in Bombay. It was called Paragon. It was to bring the advanced placement program back to India, which was basically the American version of the IB or A-levels. So I became the college board representative at the age of 21. Did that for 2 years, was looking at expanding it. Then I met a Bangalore boy, and I moved to Bangalore. So that was the first big change that happened in my career, which was very linked to a life stage, which was marriage. When I moved to Bangalore, it was very difficult to keep Paragon running in Bombay. So I shut that and joined my husband's family business, which was in pharmaceuticals. So I was finance grad, went into education, then went to pharmaceuticals. But luckily, if you've studied business, you can be in any industry, right? Because whether you're selling chewing gum or you're selling medicine, the same principles apply. So I did that for 5 years, and in fact, it was a great journey. We expanded to Sweden, to the US. As a finance student, it was very interesting to be on this side of M&A deals. And then I got pregnant somewhere along the way, and I thought, like, no, it's not a big deal. I decided to take leave for 40 days. I didn't feed at my desk, and then a baby came into my life, and things changed. And that's when the second life stage happened to me, and differently from me than from Leena, okay, for me that was a huge showstopper. And I felt that, you know, I'm like, and especially again, now this is where a lot of your upbringing, a lot of your community, your society has a lot of to play in it. My mother, my mother-in-law, my cousins, my friends, my everybody, all the women I knew, once you become a mother, you take care of your child, okay, according to everybody around me. And that's what hit me. I decided, you know what, anybody can be the CEO of Kemwell, but only one person can be the mother of this child, and that's going to be me. And I took a break. So I stopped working, and before I knew it, it was 3.5 years, and I had had a second baby. Luckily for me, though, when my second one came around, I was forced to shift my attention away from my first child. For the first time since he was born, I was forced to shift my attention away from him, and I realized that the skies didn't fall down. And in fact, it was actually good for him. You know, he started becoming more responsible, his relationship with other family members started growing, and second time around, motherhood was also easy. So, also by then, a lot of frustration had seeped in, and I was really started questioning myself whether, you know, who am I? Like, is this a person who I am? You know, constantly nagging my husband to get home in time, or wanting to have my first adult conversation of the day with him, whether even though he wanted to have that adult conversation with the TV. Anytime somebody asked you, what do? It was so difficult coming up with the answer, because saying mother, domestic engineer, housewife, nothing cut it, right? So one day I decided I needed to get back to work. And for me, that initial jump was still easy to find a job because I could jump back into our family business, right? I knew exactly what the need of the hour was. I, in fact, carved out a role for myself, which I knew I could perform. And still, even with that backing, it was still extremely difficult just because you go through a huge crisis in confidence. You know, you feel that, I mean, I was a finance grad from Wharton, and I had worked in finance now for all these years, but I felt like I didn't know anything about finance. You know, I bought myself a laptop which I could downgrade to Windows 97 because I was comfortable with the keyboard shortcuts from that Windows. And I was just not sure if I could manage both, right? After being a full-time mother for 3.5 years, I wasn't sure if I'll be doing justice to my role of motherhood plus my role in the company. So the initial plunge was very difficult. But once I started working, I realized that, oh my God, this is not rocket science. I didn't forget everything that I had worked so hard on. This was just a comma, it wasn't a full stop. And why are the women not getting back to work? So I started asking all my friends, and I'm sure many of you in this room know women who've taken a break at some point in their careers, and many of those women who've not gotten back to work. And I had friends who were lawyers, MBAs, architects, engineers, and they were just not getting back. So I started asking them why they're not getting back. And some of the reasons that they told me, right, was that one, they didn't want to go back to their old companies because your peers have become your seniors, and that's very difficult to digest. to new companies. They felt that new companies won't take them because of this gap in their resume. Okay, in fact, many of them were being told that you need to hide that gap in your resume somehow. And three, for the techies, it was just like for them, they felt it was there was no way they could get back in tech. Even if they were in tech earlier, if they were even thinking about getting back, they were looking at getting back into HR, you know. Because they said that, hey, if you've taken a break for even longer than 3 months, you've become outdated. Technology has moved on rapidly and we don't know anything anymore. So a lot of what I realized is what got me to start a portal which was exclusively for women who want to get back to work. Because the big shock that I got was when I realized that this is not just my problem or my friend's problem or the women who we know problem. There are about 1.5 million women in India who go on a break every single year. And so about 25 million women in India who are on a break and they want to get back to work, and we have to find them a path back. And that's really where JobSoha came along. So I started JobSoha last March in 2015. Again, with my very limited technical skills, I managed to cobble together a website which is actually a WordPress theme, customized WordPress theme, put it out there and got my MVP out there to just learn and understand and validate our existence. In 6 months' time, we had about, I think by then, we had about 500 companies, tons of women on the portal, we had tons of matches already made, and I realized that, okay, this is what I need to do, and this is what we need to invest in. So today, I'm happy to tell you that I have a CTO co-founder, who is, in fact, ex-Snapdeal, Microsoft, EA. He's built a strong product and tech team at JobSoha. We have a kick-ass website that we launched on June 24th, and we are across India looking at scaling it up hugely. There are 1,600 companies now who are on the portal, despite and because, sometimes, because they know that the women who are applying to their jobs are women on a career break, and they are welcoming them back.
Thanks. So before we open the floor for audience interaction, I have one question for all the three panelists. I think the question that's been bothering me is that at workplaces, we are not just women. We are managers, we are co-workers, we are colleagues, we are bosses. There are other identities and roles we play as well. Now, how is it compared to men that, you know, we negotiate these roles? What have been your experiences at the workplace? Has it really been a disadvantage to be a woman? I think that's a question that's really going on in our heads, especially after the election results yesterday, where people have come forward and said, well, you know, we should have never said Hillary Clinton was a woman. That's really what caused the election defeat. So I think this is a question that's been bothering me for a couple of days now, and especially after the results yesterday, is how do we really negotiate through these roles? What are our experiences? What are our challenges? I don't know. Anyone of you can start.
Okay, so when I'm in the office, I don't think like my gender has to play a role when I'm coding or anything, or when I'm working my sprint. So all we are engineers, and there only the skills matter. So when my managers give me some task or I have to complete my task, there it just matters. I'm able to complete it within time, the quality matters. So most of the time I have heard like, you know, there are biases in company, there are pay scale differences. But according to me, what I have seen in Ola and what I've seen in my other previous startups, the environment is really pretty cool. It must be like some girls have created that thing in their heads, or maybe it has their experiences. But in my experience or in my colleagues' experience, we haven't seen those kind of biases. We have roles to play, and in that, like I have several product managers who are women, who are like mothers also, but they get that the shit done when it comes to it, and they get it done very, you know, good, in a better way. So I just want to say that when you are in office, and it lots of depends on the culture, and a lot of things depends on the manager and the office environment. So at that time, if you are like want to play a woman victim card, like, you know, in Ola several time it happens, like we have sprints which has to go till night, like it's 12 o'clock in the midnight, but still I'm at office because, you know, I want to release that item. I feel satisfied when my things get in the prod, and like when I was developing app and I developed Ola share, so when people were using that share and when my friends introduced me to other friends, they see the girl who did Ola share, I become so happy, and I don't count the days when I have worked for nights and night, because, you know, that is the satisfying and happiest thing for me. So if you want to get equal pay scale, and if you want to get the responsibility, you have to play the responsibility equally also. So that is the thing I want to tell. Thank you.
Okay, so I can give you a contrarian view, a little bit of a contrarian view. Okay, so there are, I mean, and again, because I work in this, the kind of research I do in this and the discussions we have around this, I would say, so there are a lot of internal and external barriers, both that are holding women back when it comes to really shattering that glass ceiling, right, like Hillary Clinton. And I mean, some internal barriers, of course, have to do with what Sheryl Sandberg talks about, right? That you need to lean in, you need to sit at the table instead of holding yourself back. When, like you said, staying back and working on that sprint, getting it out the door, raising your hand if there's a very challenging project that is being offered, and not saying that, oh, but I don't think I know 100% of what is required. So there are tons of internal barriers that women face, and that kind of, I mean, one could have to do with nature and nurture, right? I mean, by nature, we women are known to be more perfectionists than men. And by nurture, you're called bossy, you're called aggressive if you are very outspoken versus a man being called a leader. So those are all the internal barriers that we go through. Even as a company, though, in corporate workplaces, there are several barriers that hold women back, right? I mean, one of the very important things when it comes to career advancement is networking opportunities. Now, when networking opportunities mostly will be in the evening or night, in bars, smoking clubs, they end up excluding women, right? And especially if there are women with families, children to go back to, it's very difficult to make the time and the bandwidth to attend those networking opportunities. And if you're not networking, and I'm sure this is true of all worlds, technical and non-technical, at the end of the day, you need to get to the right people in the companies to keep advancing in your careers. Second is, of course, finding mentors and sponsors in companies. Most of the time, if you look up, they're all men. And it's very difficult then look up in your org structure, in the company org structure, they'll be all men. And it's very difficult then for women to reach out to male mentors, sponsors, even though it shouldn't be. Men end up being more comfortable mentoring and sponsoring other men. And without getting the right mentorship and sponsorship, it's very difficult to advance in your careers. Another thing that, you know, I also see very often is flexibility. Especially in the technical world, there's a lot of flexibility that can be provided, but women are always almost judged or evaluated negatively for asking for flexibility, right? So if there was that sprint that made you work on it till midnight, it would be great if your boss said that, hey, you need to get back home to make dinner for your kids and put them to sleep. Why don't you finish doing that and then get back on the job and then finish that work today? But as long as you get the shit done, I don't care whether you're doing it from here right now or you will do it at some point during the day. And we are a long way away from flexibility in India. Even though we have technology supporting it, it's our mindset that needs to support it. In fact, in many companies also, they have run experiments where they have provided flexible job roles to men and women, and they were shocked to realize that the men were opting for it much more than the women. And the reason for that was because women were just worried about being judged negatively for opting for flexibility, right? And the men were like, oh yes, please give that flexibility to me, I would love that. So yeah, there's still a lot of internal and external barriers that we need to get across if we really want those women to reach the president of the United States level.
Yeah, so I think I agree with the internal barrier that's causing more than the external. Maybe, I don't know. My experience has been positive, like what Richa was mentioning. I have not seen a case, because I've never thought whether I can say this or I can demand this. That kind of a question luckily never occurred to me. Later, most of it like, okay, I want this, okay, I don't care what others think. Okay, I'll just state it and see what happens. Maybe I was lucky to maybe brought up in that way, or I don't know. And then it's always like that. Then I started realizing, okay, these internal barriers exist for many other people. And then I realized that, okay, I don't have to be caring about what others say. If you want it, you demand it, and then see, okay, what happens. Doesn't work, it doesn't work. Works, it's great for you. So the internal barriers, I think, has a huge play in this. Societal pressures, like how you go for work, how do you manage, right? I mean, I started ignoring it. You can't control others' behaviors. As like I mentioned, I don't think this is much to do with the gender diversity. Every place that societal pressure exists. So I would say that I had created that habit of ignoring what I don't think is relevant to me. That might have been one thing, when I look back, that would have been one thing that helped me to reach, at least, I don't know whether it's a huge ladder or something, but wherever I'm happy with my career. So, but that, how do you encourage people to do that? Like, speak up, right? I think that's what Sandy also mentioned in that book, right? I mean, you demand things, you go and ask what you want, right? See what happens, right? How do you encourage that? I think there is no when Zainab approached me for this particular talk, what I'm saying was, one thing that the question I had was, is this the right forum to bring it up? I think the problem is at homes, at colleges, at schools, right, where they don't encourage people to talk, right? I mean, when you stand up and ask a question, it was misjudged. And then that itself is like a huge discouragement when you are at 8-year-old, 10-year-old, 12-year-old. And then by the time you are 22 or 23, when you start your career, that mindset is fixed for these kind of things. So the problem is much, much before that. I think Paul Graham has written an article related to this, I believe. Someone else was telling me this. I've not read that fully. But that is, I think, is the problem, right? It has to start at a very young age. I mean, there is nothing wrong if you are asking as long as you are not doing any harm to others, you should ask things. How do you encourage that? Maybe as women, as parents, we should encourage that to our kids, and then that might be a change. It can change maybe a few years down the line. But that is where it has to start. But starting at the age of 22 or 23 might be too late. That's my thinking on this.
I think at this point, if there are any questions, we should really, or any doubts in your mind, any questions, any comments, please feel free to share them. I think we are down to the last few minutes of the panel, so it'd be good to kind of hear from the audience.
Hi, my question is to you, Neha. You said you have this portal, Jobs for Women. Do you, like you mentioned, the gap, and to cover the gap in technology is really hard. So is there some arrangement that these companies that come to you, or you yourself as an organization, provide to train these women to get back to speed?
Thank you, that's a great question. So there are lots of different initiatives we are doing to bridge that gap. One thing is, of course, that we constantly on our portal have tons of workshops, webinars that we constantly offer to help women in upskill and reskill. Second thing that we do is we get companies to offer returnee programs. So what returnee programs is, that the way college students have a 3-month, 6-month internship program, we are getting companies to offer internships for women who want to get back, right? And over, they pay the women a stipend for that period of time, and over a 3 month or 6 month period, they help in upskilling that woman on the job. And that has been a very successful way in getting back. The third thing that we're doing is, in fact, we just launched an initiative called Bring Her Back, specifically for women in tech. What we did is we got an IT giant to open up 30 job openings in 7 cities. We got Talent Bridge to provide assessment tests for each of those job openings. And then we got Simply Learn to provide retraining for those women so that they can then get hired by that IT company. So as far as women tech is concerned, if there is a gap in her career, I think the training plus job have to go hand in hand.
Thanks. My question is, like, here I can gap between the two mindsets, like the first and the middle lady. So can you give it on how can this mindset gap can be reduced, like you understand?
Okay, so I think the internal barriers the women create themselves. They think for this job they are not sufficient, their skills are not 100%. So what I have seen in guys, you know, when they don't know the new tech, what they do go to Google, learn it and say to the manager, yes, I can do that job. But what I've seen in girls, no, they go back, no, I'm scared of doing that tech, I don't know, Eric, come on. So it's depend on person to person. It does not have to play a role like a man and a woman. It just have that you have to push harder. So when you start pushing harder, you do that job and then things get done. So the differences between me and her opinion is because what are my experiences in the way I have worked, in the way I have asked, like in at some times my managers were like, you know, have given the project to that. So no, I also want work, that same amount of work. I like challenging things. So you have to go to your manager and ask them, demand that. What, like Leena also said, when you want something, you demand it, you grab it. Because the opportunity will always be not coming to you. You also have to go and take it. So that's the only thing is the difference between guys and girls I have seen. Guys go even when they are not ready, but girls, just when they think when they are 100% ready, they will, only then they will speak. That should not be the idea.
In fact, the two of us have a lot in common, because I'm really hoping that other women will also start thinking like this. So I think we should really give her a round of applause that she's already there.
Okay, hi. So this question is about looking at this. This mic has a problem, I think.
I can actually, yeah.
So this is my question would be to Neha and Zainab both, because you people see people coming in your company. So we're doing so much around women in tech, but are you seeing, is this fight bringing in any change?
We've just begun. We've really just begun. In fact, when I thought about starting jobs for her, one of the biggest things that I wanted to validate, which is why I went the complete MVP route only in Bangalore, was that will companies really take them back? And that was something that I wasn't even sure about, and that was in March 2015. It was 1.5 years ago, right? Because one, I wasn't sure that is this just social speak, or do they really mean it, right? Are they willing to put their money where their mouth is? Even today, we see a huge spectrum of companies. We see from companies ranging from companies who don't want to hire women, who don't want to hire mothers, who don't want to hire women on a career break, to companies who are looking at diversity as a checkbox, okay, two companies who really do care. And the reason why the companies which really do care is also, and we have to remember that companies are for profit. Okay, one of the companies once asked me to speak to the CSR department, and I wasn't really sure what I would say to the CSR department. But companies, the companies which are falling into the third category are the companies who are realizing that, hey, if we want to be competitive and if we want to really progress, we need to invest in our talent pipeline, and we can't ignore this talent pool. And I'm talking about, and ignore this talent pool of women, right? They don't want to build companies which are just full of men. I'm really sorry. I don't mean to offend the men, but I'm sure even the men would like to have female colleagues, because diversity is really important to get diverse perspectives and diverse capabilities. It would be such a boring world if there was only one sex in it.
I think, I don't have a straightforward answer to that question. I think that's a question that's been bothering me as well. When I look back at our conferences, sometimes you have dismal records of the fact that there's not a single woman speaker in the audience. But does that mean that there are no women practicing that particular technology? I don't think that that's really the case. I guess one of the issues that we've obviously faced is that we need to be more out there and reaching out to more and more people to participate in what we do. I'm sure there are women out there, and I think what we do recognize is the fact that one, oftentimes when you ask women to come up on stage and speak, it's like, am I really qualified to do this? And I think that's where the perfectionist issue comes up. And I think there are many times I've had this struggle, and I would tell somebody, like I was inviting somebody in this panel and the person refused, and I said, you know, this is our problem. We are just not willing to come up and speak because we somehow just feel like, you know, it's, you know, we're just not qualified to speak. And you know, that's not really about qualification, it's really about the confidence. At the same time, this is so cultural and so ingrained in us that, you know, if we don't know something end to end, then we're not going to come out and speak. The other is, there are not many women who actually talk about the work that they do, and that makes it harder to go and seek them out. And I think part of the reason that Richa is here today is because we've just been interacting, and you know, I reached out and she reached out and I got a response, and I said, okay, you know what, I think you're somebody that people have to listen to, because clearly, you know, somebody who's actually like, you know, trying to get a voice out there. And I think that that is really important. I think both for our careers as well as for our personal and political lives, that if we have to be out there, we really have to kind of make ourselves visible. And that is a question, how do we make ourselves visible? We have to start getting shameless about the fact that, you know, we're actually doing good work and we have to put it out there. So, I mean, as much as, you know, I always think in transactional terms. I'm working full-time in the company, I have a 2.5-year-old daughter, and I keep thinking, do I want to spend my time on Twitter? Because maybe sometimes I should really talk about what I do.
Almost 1.5 back, I think when you started it. So I really liked the concept of that, and at that point of time I was on a career break. So but what I felt was, whatever opportunities were there in the company, everyone asked for at least, you know, a 2-3 year experience. Okay, but what I've seen from my personal friend circle is that either they are girls who actually have a 3-year experience and then go on a career break due to marriage or whatever reason it is, or there are girls who's just passed out of their college and then just got married. Okay, it might be a personal choice or it may not be a personal choice. And then it wasn't even that, you know, they had some restrictions because of which they could not work. But somehow life turned out in such a way that they did not go back into a company to work or start their career as such. So how can you in your portal bring that up? You know, so people who are interested in getting back and starting their career but do not have relevant experience, especially in technology, can do that.
That's a really superb question, and that's something that we've been really struggling with. And I'll tell you the reason why we're struggling, because companies who have fresher roles don't want a 30-year-old woman in it. And I mean, we just released a video, in fact, and since you're following Jobs, and thank you for that, and I can't believe you knew about it 1.5 years ago when we were at MVP stage. But we just released a video which was 10 career myths of restarters, of women restarters. And the first thing we put out there was that people say that older women cannot report to younger bosses. And we put Sheryl Sandberg, who reports to 32-year-old Mark Zuckerberg, right? And of course, pretty much everybody in the tech startup world, because look at the age of the entrepreneurs. But that's a huge problem. Now, the fresher roles, they're looking for freshers. And we're trying to convince them that, hey, don't just think about that that person has to join in a role according to her age. It can be just according to her experience. So, but thank you for that feedback. That was really good.
Okay, so I wanted to ask about this extremely overused phrase about women who have it all. So for the record, I'm with Nui, who thinks that, you know, women can't. You compromise on one thing and that's the only way you can be really good at something else. So I wanted to know what your individual opinions are very quickly, because I have a feeling that you might disagree with each other.
Can you repeat it?
Okay. Can women have it all, right? So there's a lot that has been spoken about this topic, and my current take on it is that yes, we can have it all, just not at the same time. Okay, so if I'm here, then I'm not with my kids and I'm not in my office. There's a month when there's a huge drive going on at work and I need to just focus on that, then that's my all. If my kids are sick and I need to take care of them, then maybe that needs to be focused on and that's my all. So if you look at the overall picture, then yes, of course you can have it all, right? I mean, it's almost like telling men that, hey, if you're working, you can't play a sport. So you can have it all, just don't expect everything to be perfect. You don't have to be perfect at work and perfect mother and perfect wife and perfect colleague. Know that you're juggling different balls, and at some times you have to keep some balls up in the air, and that's okay. Okay, figure out at what point you need which balls to be in your hand and which ones you can keep in the air.
Yeah, I don't think I can add anything more than Neha explained it really well. Yeah, look at the only. What I do is keep only one problem at your mind. If your kids are not well, focus on that. If there is a major bug of office, then focus on that. If you have some other things at the personal life, focus on that. So I think the problem is like we try to become very perfectionist. I have to balance everything in a very perfect manner. I've given up on that. Maybe the moment I delivered my first baby, then realized that, okay, it is a compromise, right? And then keeping the right expectation with others. That I think is a major thing. Keeping the right expectation with others. Including your kids when they are growing up. Okay, this is my time. Spend quality time everywhere. So don't try to be a perfectionist. Jump in wherever you think that requires more amount of. So whoever is crying, they get the right attention.
So in my view, this time I agree with Neha and Leena that yes, you don't want to have to become perfectionist, but yes, I will say that yes, you can have it all, and the way you want it. Like if you want, you know, to get to the senior role and you want to play a major role in your company, or you want to become a CTO or CEO. Yes, definitely you can do that. Have you seen a guy who get his ambitions less just because he is becoming father? No, he never does that. So if you want to have a kid and if you want to run a company, you can do it. But just manage to get a good partner. If the good partner is there, then I think you can have it all.
We have two questions from Twitter. Before that, I wanted to ask another really small question. Do you have a go-to resource or go-to answer to deal with microaggression on an everyday basis? For example, if you're going to an interview and the interviewer asks you, are you married? Well, it's none of your business. Or if someone says, you know, you've lost weight, and they think it's a compliment, whereas it's, you know, you don't really want to hear that. So when men do that kind of thing to you at your workplace, how do you deal with it?
I can give you an example. When I went through the microaggression, did you say microaggression? Okay. So I was once asked what our revenue model was, and when I explained that, that person was not very convinced, and then he asked that, okay, tell me a little bit about your background, and I told him, and then he said, oh, the Kemwell group is behind this. The Kemwell group is your husband. And I was mad, right? He was waiting to figure out who my husband was, or who my father was, or who the man behind Jobs for Her is, to be able to figure it out in his head that, okay, this organization might work. So one thing I've realized now that I'm older and wiser is that, you know what, there's really no point of even like indulging in those conversations with those people. It's like that movie Madagascar, right? I don't know how many of you have watched Madagascar. What do they say in the end? Just smile and wave. Just smile and wave.
Yeah, don't fight with stupid. So ignore it, because you can't change others. What you can do is control yourself, right? But it takes a while to get to that level of, it need not have to be from, but I've seen it is from the society. That's a nice thing to do.
I haven't experienced that kind of question till now. Is there a man behind your success? Yes. No, I haven't experienced that, and if I do, I will, you know, what will be my reaction? I will just, you know, go mad over that person, you know, start catfighting, something like that, because this is my success that belongs to me and me only.
I had a question for Neha, actually. So I don't know whether that's allowed. So it's a very good initiative that you're doing, Jobs for Her. But are you just concentrating on the tech side? Maybe I missed out the part. Or are you also looking at the mindset shift? Because it's a change, right? I mean, yeah. Are you concentrating on that too, on women? Do you have?
We're looking at solving the problem from lots of different angles. Okay, the first and the core which needs to be solved is first bringing out enough opportunities for women, right? First, we need to make sure that those jobs are there, those companies are there who are welcoming them back. Because we can do enough of these, we can talk about it, we can mentor them, we can train them, but at the end of the day, if the job is not there, then where does that lead us, right? So we are focusing on the job, but it is extremely important, and for, I mean, all of you over here who have been successful in your careers, we need to be able to inspire and help others who are struggling, right? So, help in mentoring them, help in providing the stories of how you deal with situations, help in reskilling in whatever way possible, and in opening up opportunities. And we're doing tech, non-tech, HR, finance, admin, data entry, from CTO to data entry, we are looking at all sorts of jobs, all sorts of levels, and definitely trying for fresher jobs too.
Okay, so we have a couple of questions from Twitter. The first one is, what do each of you do towards changing the landscape for women?
I don't think I can claim I've done anything on that letting, when the conversation comes up, letting others know, okay, this is what I'm thinking. So I don't think I have much answer for that. Maybe Zainab or Richa can answer.
Can I please tell you, by being a woman CTO, she's doing a lot in changing the landscape for women in tech. Yeah, but being a role model itself is fantastic, and at least every woman in your company and women who know you know that it's possible to be a female CTO even while having a family. So I think that itself is a big job.
Yes, so Neha and Leena, I look forward to you because you are playing amazing roles there, being a mother and being a CTO and founding your company. So me being an engineer here, I think you can do it what you want. What I feel is, like, I always, whenever I meet women, I create awareness, like, you know, you have to join, pursue your career. And for that, I'm part of Women Tech Makers program, and I'm part of, which is part of BLR Droid. So I have been speaking and giving sessions for like last 2 years in the meetups. And I want to tell you that in those meetups, when so many girls come from different colleges of Bangalore, I see the a happiness in their eyes when a woman speaker is up on the stage. So when they see that thing, they get inspired. Okay, yes, I want to be there. So by taking these initiatives and having more sessions where a woman is speaking, you can inspire other people, other girls, and men can also play a role. They can mentor girls and in their team to come forward and speak here.
Now the last question is, what is on your wish list? What are some changes that you would like to see to make life for women in tech more fulfilling and fair?
One of them, which is what Neha pointed out, is flexibility. Being able to just enable, whether it's men, women, trans, whoever, to be able to have the flexibility to work from anywhere, and have better systems of accountability. I think that flexibility is extremely important, and it's important also to break your mindset that just showing up at work is not equal to productivity.
I think one of the biggest things in my wish list is for companies to stop judging the bagel by the hole, right? So for them to stop looking at the gap on women's resumes and to judge them on the basis of their aptitude and their attitude. Because at the end of the day, technology is going to change again. So you might as well hire someone who knows how to learn, right? Who can adapt, who can relearn, who can reskill herself, and take that risk, take that chance, because I'm pretty sure that they will be happy for it.
I think, my opinion, you have to go to yourself and start thinking that, okay, there is no limit. Everything is okay. Either it succeeds or it fails. Sky is not going to fall down if you fail. Right? So that internal barriers, internal frictions is what I think we have to attack more. How maybe initiatives like Job for Her will help them to do that, creating more awareness. Maybe that's one place. Okay, I have a limit. This is max I can do. That kind of thing is what we have to change. We can see more and more people doing that. Then we are making some dent.
Okay, thank you very much for this for sitting through. I'm sorry to have exceeded time, but I really hope this was worth your while. Thanks a lot to the panelists, and I think this is really inspiring.